In January of 1961, President John F. Kennedy announced that America was going to beat the Soviet Union to the moon.
Landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
To do this, NASA would need a lunar landing craft, the first true spaceship in history. The meaning of this undertaking was clear: to determine which power, America or the USSR, was technologically superior and which could innovate more boldly and more quickly. Grumman Aircraft was selected to build the Lunar Module. But there was no guidebook, no instruction manual. It had never been done. But they did have a clearly stated goal: make a machine that could safely land on the moon and then come home. From the beginning, the Lunar Module was a cluster of problems wrapped in a challenge. The machine had to be light, strong, maneuverable, and above all, reliable. If just one major component failed when it was time to come home from the moon, two men would remain on the desolate lunar surface forever. Reliability had to approach 100% in a machine that was so far removed from anything that had gone before as to seem impossible. It was as if they were trying to invent something that belonged in the 21st century and build it in the 1960s. It was a bold challenge. In short, Grumman and their engineers would have to innovate like nobody had innovated before. But first, they had to change their corporate culture. The Lunar Module was the first flying machine that would never operate in an atmosphere. It would fly only in the harsh vacuum of space. So the aerodynamic thinking that was at the core of the company went out the window. It would never fly in Earth gravity, only in zero G and the low gravity of the moon. And it only had to work once, but that one time had to be perfect. This went against Grumman's institutional culture. Many engineers looked at the drawings and the mock-ups and had fits. "That thing will never fly," they would say. "And just look at all that stuff sticking out. It's going to break off." Of course, it didn't have to fly in the traditional sense, and it only had to land on the airless moon and take off. Stuff sticking out didn't matter. Again, there was no air, so streamlining was unnecessary. So the engineers and their managers threw their instincts out the window and started with a clean sheet of drafting paper, some sharp pencils, and a trusty slide rule. This wasn't just thinking outside the box. This was reinventing the notion of what a box was. In simple terms, they wrapped some thin sheets of aluminum around the needed electronics, rocket engines, and two astronauts, and sent it to the moon. It was a bizarre-looking, paper-thin aluminum balloon, just barely adequate to do the job. The Grumman engineers set to the task with fervor. The commitment to the project was total, with many people working long past their shifts. Weekends became just another work day, and midnight was dinner time. Theirs was a task of passionate commitment and total dedication. The first step was to simplify. Everything that wasn't necessary was removed or reduced. Five landing legs were reduced to four, the hull was reduced in size, and most of the windows were removed. But it had problems. It was too heavy, way too heavy. So the engineers had to get more creative. Since the astronauts would be landing in 1/6 of Earth's gravity, it was decided to remove the seats. They could land standing up. This also allowed the astronauts to stand closer to the windows in order to get a better view of the lunar surface below. By 1966, the Lunar Module was beginning to look like a real moon machine. But the LEM was still overweight, so management offered a cash incentive to anyone at the plant who could help solve the problem. If a janitor came up with a better idea, he'd receive the bounty placed on what amounted to just grams of weight. A lot of checks were written, and the machine became slimmer still. Machinists milled the parts to minimal tolerances. They thinned the hull until it was barely thicker than a Coke can. Even a drop screwdriver could puncture it. Bit by bit, they wrestled the LEM into submission, and by the time 1968 rolled around, tests were going well. In March of 1969, the spacecraft was tested in Earth orbit with Apollo 9. Then barnstormed the moon with Apollo 10 in May. Finally, on July 20th, 1969, the moment that had so consumed the lives of everyone involved with Apollo came to pass. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin descended to a perfect landing, explored the moon, and came home, just as five more crews would in this marvelous machine. And for Apollo 13, the LEM became a lifeboat, saving the mission and the men. In its short life, Grumman's moon machine was 100% reliable and never failed to meet a single mission objective. Passion, boldness, and commitment. That's innovation, the NASA way.